This is an 1873 McNaught Compound Beam Engine. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. So most people walk right by this engine, never even giving it a second look. I suppose you can't really blame them. It's not that big. It's only maybe 10 feet tall. That huge brick wall behind it, that's the giant Watt canal pump engine. So there's certainly far bigger stuff here to look at. So you might think this is rather unremarkable, but that's unfortunate because this engine actually solved a huge problem for a lot of people. So let's say you own a factory and you buy a steam engine to power it. You scale it right so it's efficient and it can run all of your machines. You hook it up to, you know, a big overhead line drive system, you know, those long shafts with all the pulleys and leather belts and a leather belt to each of your machines. And it's working great. And it's working so well, your business is incredibly successful, and now you need to expand. And your steam engine isn't big enough anymore. And that happened, and it happened a lot. Unfortunately, the solution often left for people is that you take this big investment and you throw it out and buy a new, bigger steam engine. Or you buy a second, completely separate steam engine to power part of your factory. And now you're running two and you have more work and more maintenance costs. And neither one's really very, very good. Well, in 1845, William McNaught invented a better way to do this. Before we go into exactly what he did, there's some confusion that we should probably address. I'm speaking of William McNaught of Glasgow. And the reason I have to be specific is that the McNaught engine is sometimes credited to John McNaught. John was William's father, who was also a steam engine engineer. It's sometimes credited with William McNaught of Rochdale, who at the time was another steam engine engineer. The one who invented this was William McNaught of Glasgow. So this is the type of engine that the McNaught invention was designed to improve. As a Boulton and Watt rotative steam engine, it runs it's still an atmospheric engine, but a double acting cylinder. A lot of advancements over Watt's earlier engines. And instead of being up and down like canal pumps, this actually would turn this large geared wheel. The wheel could also be set up to run a line drive if you didn't want to run a geared system. So the thing McNaught invented was actually a process to improve the power of systems like this by adding a second cylinder. The process became known as McNaughting an engine, and engines where this was done were said to be McNaughted engines. McNaught didn't actually build all of these engines. He had the patent on it. He licensed the process, and lots of companies built or upgraded engines using McNaught's process. Let's take a look at exactly what that process was. So here we have a fairly modest-sized Harrison and Clayton steam engine. It's a beam engine built in 1873. The low-pressure cylinder on the left is a double-acting cylinder, 18-inch diameter, 36-inch stroke. That connected to the beam at the top. Comes over here to the side and down to a rotary process and out through a drive shaft. The drive shaft could then power your line drive system. This would be great in a typical factory. It could handle probably a decent sized factory, nothing huge. But this was built with an extra advantage. And if we take a look here, we can see where that advantage comes into play, which is with the second smaller cylinder on the right. That's a high pressure cylinder that was added on later. And you can see it was connected to the same beam at the top. The casting at the top shows that it was set up to actually handle that though. The high pressure cylinder is double acting cylinder also. It's only a 15 inch diameter and an 18 inch stroke. You notice it's a much shorter stroke because it's part way down the beam. And it was located between the load and the fulcrum, as opposed to sticking it on the other side right next to the main cylinder. So William McNaught invented his process in 1845. It was only 1 year sooner than that, actually, that the Lancashire boiler was invented in 1844. The Lancashire boiler allowed you to have safe boiler pressures up to about 200 PSI or even more than that if you needed to. And when that happened, a lot of places tried to create compound engines. This is an example of one of those attempts. And you see that the both of the cylinders are located on one end of the beam with the load located on the other. The high pressure cylinder is the smaller one, low pressure is the larger one. The high pressure cylinder vents into the low pressure cylinder and makes this work. Now these systems did work, but they significantly increased the stress on the system. So you see this long horizontal pipe here? That connects between the high pressure and the low pressure cylinders. And you might not think that's actually an advantage compared to the one we just looked at. But by comparison, that pipe actually lets you smooth out the motion considerably more. Just adding two cylinders makes it smoother in the first place, but adding this pipe gives you sort of a buffering of your steam pressure, and that smooths things out considerably more. Now, moving the high pressure cylinder to the side opposite the low pressure cylinder actually adds even more advantage in that it reduces a huge amount of stress from the system. For one engine, and not this one, and unfortunately I couldn't find the numbers on this one, the pressure on the fulcrum here, right in the center, that went from 85,409 pounds of pressure peak down to only 565 pounds of pressure. And that's because when you're pushing up on one cylinder, you're pulling down on the other with roughly equal force. Also, the crank pin here, which is the part that moves from the beam to your rotating line drive system, and all the components between here and, well, if you're going to a line drive system, your first belt, that stress reduced from 42,704 pounds down to 40,893 pounds peak. So not an absolutely huge jump, but certainly significant in smoothing things out. That means less wear and tear, less repair requirements, less maintenance requirements. So you get more power, you save your initial investment, and really there's no downside. So the enhancements with the McNaught engine as well as the higher pressure certainly came with lots of concerns. By the 1850s, boiler explosions in England had become really surprisingly and disturbingly common. And the second cylinder on a McNaughted engine really needed to run at least 60 PSI to be really worth installing. And ideally you would run it at closer to 100 PSI. Now, the Manchester Steam Users Association at the time would not insure any boiler with more than 60 PSI of pressure. In fact, in the early 1800s, James Watt gave up on using strong steam, which is anything over 15 PSI, because of the problems he was experiencing with boiler failures, with pipe failures. And he even suggested hanging for anyone using higher pressure than that, due to the explosion risk. In the 19th century, businesses faced the same problem they face today. You'd install equipment, it'd go obsolete, you'd outgrow it. McNaught engines like this created a way for them to save their initial investment, make money, and keep using the existing equipment. They could quickly and easily upgrade systems, and that's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Hey, before you go, I do need your help to keep this channel growing. Easiest thing you can do is just like or subscribe to the video. That tells YouTube, hey, this channel is worth watching. It'll show it to more people. Other thing you can do, completely free, is just leave a comment. More than two or three words is all it takes, and that counts as YouTube interaction. That's the strongest signal you can send to YouTube to recommend a channel to other people. Beyond that, if you can help out, this channel is actually fairly expensive to run. I usually drive 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours each way to get to these sites. So it can get pretty expensive. If you can help out with that, I have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. There's monthly memberships over there. Or if you're interested in just a one-time contribution to help out, just hit the super thanks button on this video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you at the next one.